Welcome everyone, this is Dr. Lubna and today's topic would be on agrochemical poison, which is basically pesticides. And what are pesticides? They are just a group of agents or methyl parathion, diazinon, which is also known as TIC-20, TIK-20. Diazinon is also named by TIC-20. Enterox and peroxon. So these are some of the examples. You just have to memorize a few so you know what are the alkyl and the aryl groups. Now, the organophosphorus compound is also classified according to its toxicity. This was according to the chemical structure. This classification which we have just dealt is according to its chemical structure. And furthermore, the classification according to its toxicity, if we call about, it can be termed as mildly toxic. Now, what is mildly toxic? That means that organophosphorus compound having a fatal dose more than 25 gram. And examples of mildly toxic are those compounds which are used normally in your as household insecticides, those you use at your home. So examples are chlorothione and malathion, a few examples. Then comes the moderately toxic compound. That means the fatal dose is round about between 10 to 25 gram. And these are the animal insecticides. An example is diazinon. Then comes the highly toxic group. That means the fatal dose is less than 5 gram. And these are usually the agricultural insecticides. And these are the most fatal. And this is usually, these are usually asked in the BCQ as what is the most highly toxic organophosphorus according to its toxicity. So a few examples of highly toxic agricultural insecticides would be parathion, TEPP and methyl parathion. Two or three are the most toxic if you regard the from its strength. Okay, so what is the, moving on, what is the carbamate insecticides? Now, carbamate group of insecticides, they are just a group of poisonous organic compounds which lack the phosphate group. And it has a carbamate group which is substituted instead of the alkyl or the aryl group which we have just read in the organophosphorus compound thing. So this is one of the main difference between a carbamate group and an organophosphorus group. One, that organophosphorus has an alkyl or an aryl group substituted, and in carbamate insecticide there is a phosphate group or a carbamate group substituted for the alkyl aryl group in the hydroxycarbon chain. One more difference between these two is that carbamate groups are reversible inhibitors of cholinesterase. We'll see the mode of action, how it acts, but you have to remember that the carbamate group are reversible inhibitors of cholinesterase. And hence the symptoms obviously are less severe and of a shorter duration. And as carbamates also do not penetrate the CNS effectively. So the toxic features which are related to the CNS, they are also not that much prominent. So these are two basic differences between a carbamate group and an organophosphorus group. And you can see the examples of the carbamate group seen on the screen. Now, the mode of action. Mode of action, you have to first know that acetylcholine is a neurotransmitter that affects the preganglionic and the postganglionic parasympathetic synapses. And from that, you must be knowing that this is a muscarinic action. And also it affects the sympathetic preganglionic synapses, including the adrenal medulla, which is the nicotinic receptor, nicotinic actions over there. So, also, it is a transmitter in the CNS. So it has its action on three main parts. It has a parasympathetic action. It has a nicotinic action and a effect on the CNS. What happens at the synapse that this acetylcholine is hydrolyzed by the enzyme acetylcholine cholinesterase, which is present at the ganglions and the myoneural junctions. And this is responsible, this enzyme is responsible for the degradation of acetylcholine into choline and acetic acid. So what happens when a poison like organophosphorus acts here? This causes irreversible inhibition of this enzyme, acetylcholine esterase. And what happens? Obviously, results in accumulation of a acetylcholine at the synapses. Now, what happens? The accumulated effect of acetylcholine, this causes hyperexcitation of the first the involuntary muscles, then the secretory glands, and the last of all the voluntary muscles, and finally the brain centers. And continued and overstimulation of the local muscarinic and the nicotinic receptors would result in eventual paralysis of the nerve and the muscle. So this is how the organophosphorus compound acts. Now, moving on, this we have just discussed. Now, the fatal dose, like we said, it varies with the type of compound. I've already told you the classification of organophosphorus according to its toxicity regarding the strength and all. But the fatal dose of carbamate ranges between 25 milligram to 350 milligram given orally, if given orally. The sign and symptoms, the fatal period, and the fatal period of both organophosphorus and carbamate ranges from about half an hour to 3 weeks. Now, portal of entry, how organophosphorus can enter your body. It can occur through like contact even with the intact skin. It can from the open wounds, from the mucous membrane of the skin, GIT, respiratory tract, by inhalation, transconjunctival it can enter, transdermal it can enter. So there are many routes of entry by which the organophosphorus can enter the body and cause the symptoms and signs. Now, as soon as the symptoms start, we can classify these symptoms into the muscarinic effects, the nicotinic effects, and the CNS effects. If we talk generally, when a patient comes to us with signs and symptoms of organophosphorus toxicity, they are generalized signs, initial complaints of headache, nausea, giddiness, and tightness in the chest, and there is profuse frothing from the mouth and nostrils, and so on and so forth. And in another 2 to 8 hours, this starting with cramps and vomiting, diarrhea, profuse sweating occurs usually, and there are muscular twitchings and so on and so forth. Bronchial secretions are increased, there is bronchi and leading on to respiratory muscle paralysis, which is mainly the cause of death in organophosphorus poisoning. But if we talk in a more focused question, how the muscarinic like effects, what are the muscarinic effects, and what are the nicotinic effects? So we'll be seeing these were the early symptoms which it has talked about, and these are the late symptoms, generalized symptoms. Now, these are the muscarinic like effects that when the, like we said, the parasympathetic manifestations, you can say. So all the parasympathetic manifestations in all the, whether it's the respiratory tract or the GIT or the eye, you'll be seeing all the parasympathetic manifestations. What are they? Like if you talk about the bronchial tree, the patient would come to us with tightness in the chest, chest pain, dyspnea, cough, and like bronchoconstriction, there's a lot of bronchial secretions going on, and this prolonged wheezing expiration. So when the patient comes, the effect simulate that of a bronchial asthmatic patient. It's the same picture he presents that whether he's suffering from that, and when you come to know the details, then you see that this is more like a organophosphorus poisoning symptoms. Then this the on the gastrointestinal tract, if you see the effects, all again the parasympathetic manifestations like increased salivation and heartburn, diarrhea, increased defecation, irritation, cramps, anorexia, and so on, tenesmus. The effects on the heart would be a slowed heart rate, which is bradycardia. Eyes, what happens is that although this is a bit rare, but you see shedding of red colored tears. These red colored tears are also known as chromogenic tears or chromolecreuria. This is also known as chromolecreuria, due to which what happens is there is accumulation of porphyrins in the lacrimal gland, and they cause these red colored tears. Also, there's constriction of the pupil, which is meiosis, blurred vision due to unequal size of the pupils. So there's blurred vision and all. This is also a characteristic feature this meiosis and thing, but usually this is not present in all cases, although this is a characteristic feature of organophosphorus poisoning. Then on the skin, you can see excessive sweating. Like we said, urinary bladder, there is frequency of micturition and incontinence of urine. And also, now the nicotinic effects, if we come to that, the nicotinic effects would be the somatic motor and on the sympathetic nerve endings, or the autonomic ganglion and the somatic motor effect. The nicotinic effect of the organophosphorus is usually seen at the motor end plates of the neuromuscular junction of the striated muscle. So nicotinic effects is most highly prominent in the striated muscles, because the motor neurons and the sympathetic nerve endings are present over there. So what you see in the striated muscle, you see a lot of fatigue, muscle weakness, twitching, fasciculations, and muscle cramps going on. There is usually absence, loss of tendon reflexes, and eventually leading to paralysis of the muscle. On the cardiovascular effect, if it is a pure nicotinic effect, so you'll be seeing increase in the heart rate and blood pressure, which is tachycardia. Now, on the central nervous system, if you see the effects of organophosphorus poisoning, the patient would come with increased headache, restlessness, there'll be slurred speech, confusion, fine fibrillary tremors of the hand, lips, face, and tongue. This mental confusion usually progresses to convulsions, coma, and later on seizures, and so on and so forth. Sign and symptoms, usually they are dependent on the degree of exposure. The greater the degree of exposure, the greater you will see the effects and the sign and symptoms. Additional points, like there's always a garlic-like odor when a patient comes to us showing sign and symptoms of organophosphorus poisoning. There's a typical garlic-like odor, or you can see a kerosene-like odor from the emitting. Because kerosene-like odor, because usually the organophosphorus is dissolved in a diluent, and that gives a kerosene-like smell. Or sometimes, if not a diluent is not used, garlic-like odor is usually seen emitting from the clothes and from his mouth and stuff. Skin exposed to the poison is usually red and blistered. Now, one easy way to remember how you will remember the muscarinic actions, this would be done by a mnemonic. The mnemonic, what is the mnemonic usually? This can be remembered by the name sludge. Sludge M. Sludge, S-L-U-D-G-E and capital M. Sludge M or dumbbell. Now, from this, what can you make out? Sludge showing S, increased salivation, L, increased lacrimation, U, increased urination, D, diarrhea, G, gastric distress, and E, emesis, which is vomiting, and M standing for meiosis. And another mnemonic to remember is for the muscarinic action is dumbbell, D-U-M-B-E-L-S. So D, again, diarrhea, U, increased urination, M, meiosis, B stands for bronchorrhea and bronchoconstriction and bronchospasm and increased bronchial secretions. E, again, emesis, and S for increased salivation. So this is a very easy way. By these two mnemonics, you can remember the specific sign and symptoms relating to the muscarinic actions of organophosphorus. And how to remember the nicotinic action? For that, there is a mnemonic, MATCH. M-A-T-C-H. M standing for muscle weakness and fasciculations, muscle fasciculations. A for the adrenal medulla increase activity. T for tachycardia. And C for cramps in the muscle. And H for hypertension. So by these two mnemonics, at least if you don't remember the whole thing, you can at least go through that these would be the parasympathetic and the sympathetic actions. Cause of death, like we said, mainly because of respiratory paralysis or failure, or it can be due to circulatory arrest or leading on to edema, lungs, brain internally. Now, treatment, if we come back to the treatment, before treatment, I would like to tell you how this is diagnosed. Mainly done by the clinical diagnosis of organophosphorus. Patient comes to you with the typical sign and symptoms, froth from the mouth and dyspnea and so on. We talked in a lot of detail. But another mainstay of this diagnosis is the lab diagnosis. How do you diagnose this from the lab? Now, we have seen that It is the cholinesterase activity, which which is inhibited. See, so we have to see this cholinesterase levels in the RBC, which is the true cholinesterase level. And if we see the cholinesterase activity in the plasma, so that would be the pseudocholinesterase levels which we see. And we'll tell you why it's called pseudo. So what we have to see is if the RBC cholinesterase level is less than 50% of the normal, what does this indicate? This is organophosphate toxicity going on. Essential findings so in the lab is depression of the cholinesterase activity. And like we said, the sign and symptoms appear when greater than 50% cholinesterase is inhibited. Okay, greater than 50%. Some say it is, some books say 30%, but ranging from, you could say, because it's not always a typical, you have to give in range exactly. So you can say some books say greater than 30% and some say greater than 50% cholinesterase activity when it is inhibited in the RBC, then you can measure that this person is going towards organophosphate toxicity. Now, why we call the pseudocholinesterase level in the plasma? Because pseudo means that cholinesterase in the plasma when you measure is not that accurate, not that reliable, and the cholinesterase level, they decline more rapidly as compared to the RBC levels of cholinesterase. So it is known as pseudocholinesterase level. Also, the depression of the cholinesterase in the plasma level is not specific, because it can be seen in other conditions like cirrhosis of liver and malnutrition and septicemia due to burns, neoplasia, obstructive jaundice, and so on. So this level is not specific for just organophosphorus poisoning. So what we see is the levels of cholinesterase activity in the RBC, that is the true cholinesterase. Now, also, this activity can also be determined in the vomitus or the gastric aspirate. You can see the organophosphate levels from the vomitus or the gastric. The gastric and the vomitus level can be seen not in this cholinesterase level, but there is another test which is a confirmatory test. How you confirm that this is actually an organophosphorus poisoning, and that is what? A p-nitrophenol test. P-nitrophenol, what is P-nitrophenol? It is just a metabolite of some of the OPCs, and this is usually excreted in the urine. So excretion in the urine confirming this, that P-nitrophenol is present, can give you a confirmation test for OPC poisoning. So, and this test can also be performed on vomitus or the gastric aspirate. Urine confirmatory, but can be performed on in your vomitus and gastric aspirate. Other things by which you can do the diagnosis of organophosphate is thin layer chromatography and spectrophotometry, but these are so sensitive and a bit expensive and all. So this lab diagnosis is very easy way to diagnose it. Now, cause of death, now coming on to the treatment. Now, treatment may be summarized as, like you can say, the first of all is decontamination. Decontamination means that you have to remove the person from the source of poison. And the physician in charge of the nursing patient should wear rubber gloves, because like we said, from the skin, the absorption can take place and affect the person who is giving the care and giving the treatment. So remove the person, strip all contaminated clothes, wash the skin with soap and water thoroughly, and you can do gastric lavage with water or potassium permanganate. Yeah. So this is the... this is how you treat, and the general measures. What are the general measures? How you would treat the organophosphorus poisoning? If you have to do the suction, you do that with the raising the foot end of the bed to ensure proper drainage. You can give this postural drainage, and you can give oxygen for bronchial hypersecretions. You can intubate the patient. You can even do tracheostomy or give artificial respiratory support if required. But the mainstay of treatment in organophosphorus poisoning, this is care of the airway and how you do intubate the patient. You can see from the picture. The mainstay of treatment of organophosphorus poisoning is the specific antidote, which is atropine. So atropine, preservative-free atropine, drug of choice. How you give atropine? First, there is just initial dose of 1 milligram, just to make sure that the strength of 2 to 4 milligram IV or IM you have to give every 10 to 15 minutes. You have to keep on giving atropine and till atropinization is achieved. Now, what is atropinization? We'll tell you that how you can see that atropinization, what is the term by means of which you mean atropinization? Atropinization is just a thing in which you see that the there is effects resulting from what you have given atropine, and this drying of secretions, there is tachycardia, there's now flushing of face, warm skin, dry mouth, dilated pupils, you know, patient coming back to his normal form. You can mitigate the parasympathetic effects of the organophosphorus. So this is atropinization. You have to keep on giving atropine till this, these signs and symptoms start appearing. Now, we say, because in organophosphorus, this constriction of pupil. Atropinization, what we achieve? We achieve mydriasis or dilatation of the pupil. But mydriasis is just an early response. We should not consider this dilatation of pupil as an end point of atropinization, atropine use, because we have to keep on continuing giving atropine at low doses and less frequent intervals to maintain this atropinization. And this is usually done for another 24 to 48 hours, or even if it stretches to a week or so, we can keep on maintaining the patient on atropine at these low doses and, like we say, low frequency intervals. Sometimes we have to give, even in a day, we have to give 40 milligrams to about 200 milligrams per day of atropine per day, or even more, some say. So, like we say, till we achieve the desired target and we remove those symptoms. One more thing here to remember is that the atropine which we give, that can reverse the muscarinic actions that take place due to organophosphorus poisoning. They do not reverse the muscle weakness. That is, they do not reverse the nicotinic effects which have taken place due to organophosphorus poisoning. Neither they do some help in the respiratory paralysis or the CNS symptoms which take place due to organophosphorus poisoning. So this atropine is just specific for, you can say, for relieving the muscarinic actions or making it better. Not on the muscle weakness. They have no effect whatsoever on the relieving the muscular weakness and so on. Now, another thing which can see this, you can see, like we said, atropinization, drying of secretions and tachycardia, flushing, dry mouth and dilated pupils. Okay, as you can see. And this I've told you how you have to administer the atropine. Now, another mainstay of treatment is cholinesterase reactivators. There are certain oxime compounds which you give to reactivate the phosphorylated acetylcholinesterase. And they are usually used to supplement the atropine therapy. Not like, like we said, atropine is a mainstay of treatment and cholinesterase reactivators are just used as a supplement with atropine therapy. And what they do is they reactivate the phosphorylated acetylcholine. And they are, if given within 12 to 24 hours of organophosphorus poisoning, they are more effective. But here also, one very important thing to remember is that cholinesterase reactivators, they are contraindicated in carbamate poisoning. Remember, this is very important in ECQ usually when we give you the option. This cholinesterase reactivator is contraindicated in carbamate poisoning because usually what it does is sometimes it reversibly inhibits the acetylcholinesterase and their administration usually worsens the symptoms. So it is not given in carbamate poisoning. And general measures, what other things you do is, I'll also show you the names of the cholinesterase reactivators if you have that. Yes, we have a slide on that. So this also very long names, but you just have to remember the abbreviations PAM, P-A-M, P2S, second is P2S, and the third one is toxigonine or obidoxin. You don't have to even remember specifically the strength, how much you give and how to give, but at least the names should be remembered, that cholinesterase reactivators are mainly three, PAM, PAM, PAM remembered by PAM, P2S, and toxigonine and obidoxin. What are the general measures that you use? You can use barbiturates or diazepam for if there are convulsions taking place. You can use diuretics, Lasix may be required. Bronchodilators usually improve the respiration, so you can give that. and if necessary, tracheostomy or mechanical ventilation if necessary. So moving on to the postmortem findings of these other general measures, the signs of asphyxia, this is the most important. Whenever the postmortem, the patient dies due to organophosphorus poisoning, they are typical signs of asphyxia, very evident. And what are they? Usually you can see from the external postmortem appearance, faces, cynos, this blood-stained froth coming out from the nose and mouth. And like we said, typical garlic-like odor is present, or a kerosene-like smell, like we told you, due to the diluent which is used. The poison can be perceived, smell coming from the mouth and the clothes as well. So these are the typical findings of that. If we move on to the internal finding, the stomach itself would be blood-stained with congestion of the mucosa, petechial hemorrhage. Again, garlic odor not just emitting from the externally from the mouth and the clothes, but also from the contents of the stomach and the mucosa and all. You'll see as soon as you open the stomach and you see the garlic odor coming emitting from that place. From the lungs are usually edematous, petechial hemorrhages are present. Brain also, all signs of hyperemia and petechial hemorrhages are present. All the organs are, you can say, congested and hyperemic in general. Okay, what is the medico-legal importance now? Medico-legally, the most common medico-legal importance is accidental deaths taking place. Because accidentally it is used in sprayers, those like we said, because I forgot to mention that organophosphorus is usually used as a pesticide in fumigation, the crops, spraying the crops, you know, in the agricultural fields. So most commonly when you're spraying it, the people tend to get this toxic effects of organophosphorus poisoning. Similarly, in the manufacturers or the packers, they usually get the signs and symptoms of that if they don't take the precautions and all. Then suicidal is common in our country because of the easy availability of the poison. It is present there, and whenever a person or anyone thinks of committing suicide, the most easily available thing as a household pesticide commonly available is this, and people tend to ingest it. Then homicidal is a bit rare because of the detectable smell of the substance used in the diluent. And also the signs and symptoms are so alarming and they appear so early that usually not a typical thing to be used for homicidal purposes. So this was the organophosphorus. Then comes the chlorinated insecticide. This is also a group of insecticides, and here you can see that the chlorine, here the only thing different from the organophosphorus is that chlorine is present in the molecular structure. And the most important out of all these, you must have heard a lot about DDT. DDT, PR, kisine, or wo. This is also because of the easy availability, easy approach usually present. Because hamari bahut se is tarah hamare gharon mein jo mop ke liye use hoti hain cheezein, usme ya aur cheezon mein hum jo pesticides, insects kill karne ke liye usually cheezein use karte hain usme. This is the most effective for that. But here it can also be used for suicidal purposes. So DDT, most common. Then other things, gamhexane and hexaphane, aldrin, but the most common will be dealing with just DDT, mainly DDT. This is, like we said, the most commonly used chlorogroup of insecticides. It's a powdered DDT, usually white crystalline solid hota hai, readily soluble in kerosene oil, aur usi ki wajah se used to kill flies, mosquitoes, fleas and bed bugs. Usually here, portal of entry wagaira is the same, wahi oral se, local se, inhalation se, skin and mucous membrane se. But here one thing is different, that is, DDT is highly lipophilic and this tends to accumulate mainly in the adipose tissue and the body fat. So wahan pe symptoms karta rehta hai. Aur usually general symptoms are usually the same as we discussed, hoi nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, vertigo, cough, muscle tremors, weakness, paralysis of the legs. So these are the generalized signs and symptoms. But here, one thing also here is a bit different, that the most common and serious feature occurring here, if it is a case of poison by DDT, is seizures, which occur without any prodromal features of GIT toxicity. So here, this is a very serious thing. Sometimes the patient without these GIT symptoms and respiratory symptoms directly coming to us with seizures. So this is very important and serious, dangerous, you can say, effect of DDT poisoning. So fatal dose usually is ranging from 150 to 160 milligram per kg of body weight. Just you have to remember that for academic purpose. Fatal period is usually half hour of these chlorinated compounds. This is usually the same, the gastric lavage with the mode of action. One more thing to remember is it acts mainly, like we said, seizures is the most important feature of that coming to us directly, because this acts on the motor cortex and the cerebellum. So this is why there's a reason you can see the CNS symptoms are so much obvious and prominent and more dangerous without sometimes without the prodromal, like we said, symptoms of GIT. Okay, so moving on, portal of entry, we have done sign symptoms, we have done fatal dose, we have done fatal period half hour to 4 hour, treatment coming on, the gastric lavage we have done and all that. We can give atropine to prevent the pulmonary edema, calcium gluconate and oxygen inhalation and all. But here also one thing different is what you can use is you can use cholestyramine. What is cholestyramine? It is just a non-absorbable bile. And what it does is it enhances the fecal excretion of organochlorine compounds. It can be mixed with fruit juice or given orally. So this is also one of the mainstay of treatment of organochlorine compounds of poisoning that you can give cholestyramine, which is just like we said, the non-absorbable bile. So again, the postmortem appearance here also would be the same. The signs of asphyxia and the smell of kerosene emitting from the stomach and all, this would be the same as we have already dealt. Medico-legal importance here of DDT and all is also, it is used for suicidal purpose like we discussed. Accidental poisoning can occur, especially in children who have access to the poisoning, and tolerance for the poisoning is less in children, obviously, and those who handle the poison. So it can occur, accidental poisoning can occur. Homicidal is a bit rare because while we said it is because of the smell of kerosene and all. One more chlorinated group of compound, which organochlorine compound, which is not given here in the slide, and which I would like you to just, before going on to naphthalene, we would discuss that. This is endrin, E-D-R-I-N. Endrin is also asked, but unfortunately, we don't have a slide on endrin. So you just have to listen to me. This is also a chlorinated insecticide, endrin. And why it is important? Because endrin is one of the most toxic out of all the chlorinated group of insecticides. It is considered to be the most toxic. It is usually synthetic, fat soluble, water soluble also. And it is a very unpleasant and bitter taste and smell. Chiefly, it is used against insects, pests, and all that. But this insecticide is also used against the plant pest. So therefore, this is known as plant penicillin also. Endrin is also known as plant penicillin. Why? Because this is also effective against being used against the plant pest. In the market, usually it is sold mixed with 50 to 80% of solvent. There's a solvent called Aromax, A-R-O-M-A-X. So usually endrin in the market is sold dissolved in this solvent. Aromax is actually just a petroleum hydrocarbon smelling, giving a smell like kerosene. Therefore, this poison also gives you the smell of kerosene whenever this takes place. Then toxic effects of endrin. This is also important. The toxic effect, like we said, this is the most toxic. Toxicity follows rapidly following inhalation or ingestion or even skin contamination. And usually the toxic symptoms appear within half hour, and by 1 to 2 hours, the most toxic symptoms start appearing. CNS symptoms also, do we have a chat? Please spell it again. Navera, can you tell me what to spell? Because you have not written what spelling you want me, what thing you want me to spell. So can you just specify so I can tell you the spelling? And moving on, this to endrin, like we said, the plant penicillin. The plant penicillin is, spell it again, the plant penicillin. Enderin, we are talking about the organochlorine group of insecticides, and this, like we said, is used as a plant penicillin also, because it is effective against the plant pesticides. So this is okay. So moving on, this CNS symptoms, if you see of Enderin, this is again restlessness, irritability. But here, one feature which differentiates it from the organophosphorus compound is that there is dilatation of the pupil usually, and there is tonic and clonic convulsions and coma, leading on to coma. So Enderin, one thing, highly toxic organochlorine compound. It causes dilatation of the pupil, usually seizures. Person comes to the prodromal symptoms of GIT, person comes to us with seizures and typical manifestations, CNS manifestations. And like we said, Enderin causes dilatation of the pupil rather than meiosis. So this is also one of the difference from organophosphorus. Death again is resulting from respiratory failure. And in general, you have to remember that whether it's organophosphorus or whether it is Enderin poisoning, these can be detected in the exhumed bodies. They resist putrefaction. All these poisons, they resist putrefaction. So they can be detected in the exhumed bodies. And if we are talking about Enderin, since alcohol is used to mask its smell, so for homicidal, if you give it, so like we said, the person can easily detect that you are giving him by the smell and all. But here, Enderin, then the toxic dose is so less and it acts in such a rapid manner that what happens is the victim, without recognizing, while he is eating, even if he takes in a little amount of food which contains Enderin, the toxic amount has already been swallowed by the time he has taken a bite of food or whatever he has taken. So this is so dangerous. So for homicidal purpose also, Enderin can be given, unlike the organophosphorus, which from the smell and because of the dosage is a bit high, you can detect and you can avoid taking it. So, and obviously for suicidal purpose, because it is cheap, it is freely available, you can use it for that purpose. So this was all for Enderin. Now, moving on to another group, which is naphthalene. Now, naphthalene, you must be knowing, okay, this is very common thing. You call it mothballs and all. This is a pesticide which is used in as deodorant laboratories and dyeing industry and things as a equipment for insulator. But most common household use of naphthalene is mothball, which is white crystalline solid balls. Or Urdu mein agar aap kahein, to hum bahut commonly phenyl ki goliyan. Humne apne childhood se we keep on hearing ke ye dalte the, aur hamari nani ya dadiyan jo hain, they used to place these mothballs, phenyl ki goliyan, garam kapdo mein, taaki wo garam kapde, kehte the, wo bache rahe aur wo kidon se aur pesticide aur inse bache rahe. Even today, I think most of the homes household thing, people, usually ladies, they use these mothballs for in the koi bhi aap garam kapdon mein rakhe ya dusre kapdon mein rakhe to usse ye hota hai ki usse keeda lagne se bachta hai. That was the concept of mothballs and naphthalene. And why we are doing it here, because this is also comes under the heading of agrochemical poisoning, and the fatal dose is about 2 grams. Sign and symptoms may of naphthalene are usually, fatal period is like few hours to 3 days. Sign and symptoms of naphthalene is usually the same. There's headache, nausea, vomiting, staggering gait. But main thing, very easy to remember, there are 3 things which occur in these are the generalized sign and symptoms. Before that, just remember the naphthalene, 3 cheezon mein it acts, like it is a nephrotoxic, it is a hepatotoxic, and it is a hemolytic. And it also causes optic neuritis. So these are the four main features that, if you remember, it will be very easy to lead you on that if a patient comes with the sign and symptoms which are varying, but you will come to know these are the 4 major sites on which it's act. Like again, nephrotoxic, hepatotoxic, hemolytic, and causing optic neuritis, causing blindness even. So if we come to the kidney, if we talk about kidney, it causes acute nephritis. There's painful micturition, usually dark brown colored urine coming in because it contains albuminuria and hemoglobin in it. Also, because it's like we said, causes hemolytic anemia. So because of the hemolysis, there's blockage of renal tubules and hemoglobinuria, and, you know, by means of which hepatic necrosis and jaundice taking place. So these are some of the signs and symptoms of naphthalene poisoning. Usually, if it comes in direct contact with the skin or with the conjunctivita, it causes dermatitis and conjunctivitis. One also important thing to remember here is that the hemolysis which occurs, usually it occurs only in those which have a hereditary deficiency of glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase in the red cells. Usually those persons who are susceptible to that genetically, which have a deficiency of an enzyme, glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase, only in those persons usually the hemolysis occurs and hemolytic anemia occurs because of naphthalene. So if we come to the treatment of naphthalene poisoning person and come to us, we just have to keep him warm, give him a stomach wash with warm water or saline. Purgatives are usually used like magnesium sulfate to flush out the effects of naphthalene. And also one thing to remember is that oily and fatty preparations like milk and stuff, fatty preparations should be avoided as they facilitate the absorption of naphthalene. So they should be usually avoided. And blood transfusions can be given generalized, hydrocortisone can be given for hemolysis and things like that. So these are just the general treatment of naphthalene. But a main thing to remember is that any avoid fat or any oily or fatty preparations, even milk, should not be given because, like we said, as they facilitate the absorption. If the person dies because of naphthalene poisoning, the postmortem appearance, typically they'll be, because of the jaundice and hemolysis going on, there'll be yellow skin coloration, discoloration of the skin. The gastric mucosa is even yellow, congested, inflamed, and there'll be greater damage, like we said, to the liver and the kidney. So all the symptoms, the signs would be obvious when we open the body and we see the liver and the kidney. They are highly damaged. Even the respiratory tract shows signs of irritation and all. Now, this was for naphthalene poisoning. This, like you said, the postmortem appearance and the medico-legal importance again is the same. Mostly, this is accidental, like we said. Why? Because we've already discussed that it is common in children as they ingest the naphthalene balls. And even in the adults, because of the inhalation of the naphthalene vapors due to the heavy dusting, like we said, they are used in bed clothing to as a pesticide and all. So even the adults can inhale a lot of naphthalene vapors due to the heavy dusting of bed clothes. So children and adults may be affected. Accidental poisoning can occur. Suicidal is a bit rare, but not that much seen. Naphthalene is also not soluble in water. So it remains in the garment for even after washing. So you have to be careful for that also. It's not means that you've washed it, so you're safe from that. Also, it is soluble in oil. So in babies, accidental poisoning can occur because you use it, because we use for massage and all, we use baby oil. And if the naphthalene is it can be absorbed from the skin and all. So absorption to the skin can occur and naphthalene accidental poisoning can occur in children because, like we said, it is soluble in oil. So baby oil can promote the absorption of naphthalene. So now, this, I think, okay, no, not thank you as yet, because we have another person, but unfortunately, like we said, we don't have the slide available. So this, you have to listen to me, you have to hear me out, because we don't have the slide available. And this last poison is that of aluminium phosphide. And aluminium phosphide, like we said, it is sort of used as a aluminium phosphide. Slide is not available, so please, students, just hear me out carefully so you can jot down the important points. Aluminium phosphide is also known by the name of agent of sure death. Sometimes this is used to be a favorite basic cue of most of the examiners and also in the Viva. What is the agent of sure death? So I don't know why, but they used to say, okay, this aluminium phosphide is the agent of sure death. And it is mainly used as a grain preservative. Grain preservative. So its availability is usually, it occurs in the form of a grayish green tablets, about 3 grams. One tablet is 3 grams or so. And what it does is that each tablet, it releases 1 gram of phosphine. You know, this phosphine is the main thing that as it evolves, it causes the signs and symptoms and the toxic effects. this the fatal dose of aluminium phosphide, like we said, 3 gram, fatal period is about 12 to 36 hours. How it acts, the aluminium phosphide, like we said, the aluminium phosphide, it liberates the phosphine as soon as it comes with in contact with air or moisture, or as soon as a person ingests a tablet of aluminium phosphide, it comes in contact with the acidic media, that is the HCl present in your stomach, and this releases the phosphine, which is rapidly absorbed from the gastrointestinal tract by just simple diffusion. Phosphine itself, now what it does, the damage it causes. The phosphine is a highly, it is a protoplasmic poison, and it mainly interferes with the enzyme and the protein synthesis, and also inhibits the cytochrome oxidase system of enzyme. So you can see the lot of damage being caused by this, just this one tablet of aluminium phosphide. The features that come to us with a very anxious look, they present to the emergency room with profuse sweating, there is metallic taste, speak that there is a metallic taste they can have in their mouth. Again, a garlicky, fishy odor coming from the breath, there's upper abdominal pain, but mainly the main feature of this is persistent hypotension, usually if the person presents late to us after 6 hours or so, and if he presents with persistent hypotension, so we can make out that significant death can be the probable outcome of this. So it is that dangerous if a person comes late, because like we said, this persistent hypotension, and the person comes to us in a state of shock. So the remaining features are the same as we have discussed for other organic compounds and all that. Diagnosis, again, we said by the typical garlicky or the fishy smell coming. Also, the lab diagnosis can be done from the altered liver function test by the race, transaminase level and the bilirubin levels, by the increased prothrombin time. Usually when we do the ABG, that shows metabolic acidosis. And also signs can also be seen in the ECG of even an organophosphorus. You can have a ECG done and you can see the ST depression and the T wave inversions and all. One thing, how you can diagnose this aluminium phosphide also, it can be a bedside test also. It is known as a silver nitrate test. How you do it? You ask the patient to breathe through a piece of filter paper, which is already impregnated with 0.1% silver nitrate. For, let's say, for 5 to 10 minutes, you ask him to breathe through that impregnated silver nitrate filter paper. If the filter paper turns black after like 5 minutes or so, this would suggest the presence of phosphine. And this blackening, which takes place, is usually due to because of the fact that phosphine reduces the silver nitrate to silver, and that gives the typical black color. So you can very easily see by the color and all. Even the management and all we have done, it's almost the same. We have to manage we have to secure the airway, the typical things, oxygen and all, manage the shock. We have to manage the shock with intravenous fluid, obviously, and with inotropic support. We have to manage the metabolic acidosis with usually sodium bicarbonate, magnesium sulfate administration. People say it's controversial whether you give it or not. Gastric lavage is also, some people say it is contraindicated, because again, if it comes in contact with water, the phosphine, if this phosphine is present in the remaining in the stomach, so it will react with that. But again, some people are of the thought, old thought, people, they say that you can do the gastric lavage with potassium permanganate and all. So there is a varying controversy regarding the gastric lavage thing also. But to be on the safe side, you can give if you want, if the person comes to you in time. Suicidal poisoning is quite common with this agent. Rarely accidental poisoning, like we said, can occur in those persons who are working in the grain elevators or warehouses containing grain and all. So this was about it. One thing I think we'll just check if I've left that enhancement of Excretion, yes. Phosphine is usually excreted, like we said, through the lungs and kidneys, so adequate hydration, which we have talked about, and renal perfusion should be maintained by IV fluids, obviously. You have to give a lot of IV fluids to prevent the shock and also to enhance the excretion of phosphine. One recent research which usually states that various fats and oils like coconut oil, when used in gastric lavage, can help to decrease the absorption of phosphine gas from the stomach. So this research is going on, not yet proven as yet. So you don't have to go by it, you have to give in our daily practices and all. But this is just one of the extra things which is just going on. So I thought I would tell you. So yeah, this is about it. And we have dealt with almost all. If you have any queries, questions, you can ask, although this was quite a huge topic, but thankfully we have dealt in time. So anything which you need to ask, otherwise we have done. If you want, we can browse through the slides again. And if you have missed anything, you can just go through this slide. But even if you have listened to the lecture, I think everything has been made so clear that no need to, you can read it from the book. You can just give a one breathing or from the mnemonics also of the muscarinic and the nicotinic effects. So this is it. So this is it from my side, guys. So I'll take my leave. Okay, no questions. जी नुमान, आई थिंक मैंने कर दिया है. और जी, तो दिस इज इट. सो आई विल जस्ट वेट अनदर मिनट इफ यू गाइज नीड टू आस्क मी एनीथिंग. जी नुमान, मेरा लेक्चर हो गया है, अगर आप करें तो मैं.
हेलो, सलाम वालेकुम।
जी, वालेकुम सलाम. जी नुमान, मैंने कर दिया है, लेक्चर हो गया डिलीवर.
ठीक है मैम, एंड कर दूं?
जी.
ओके, थैंक यू सो मच मैम, थैंक
थैंक
यू
यू
सो
थैंक
मच,
यू थैंक
जजाकल्ला।
यू.